Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Rona Citrin, and I'm a trustee here at Anderson Ranch. It's my pleasure to introduce Adam Lerner, who will be moderating today's conversation with Los Angeles-based photographer and filmmaker Alex Prager. Adam Lerner is a director and chief animator of the Museum of Contemporary Art Denver. He has curated dozens of exhibitions and projects with contemporary artists such as Barnaby Furness, Liam Gillick, Isaac Julian, and Christian Markley. As self-appointed chief animator, Adam believes his role is to bring art to life. Adam's unique approach to museum programming, which combines curatorial, education, and artistic production, has been adopted by museums throughout North America and celebrated by leaders in the field and the general media. A 2011 article in the New York Times stated that Adam's work to engage audiences is reshaping what has become a stale model for a contemporary art museum. According to Adam, two of the MCA Denver's primary goals are this: to help patrons view the world from a fresh perspective and broaden the definition of art. In an interview with Confluence Denver, Adam said, "Letting go of conventions is what gives you something authentic and meaningful. The spirit of art has always been about rule breaking and identifying social conventions, then going outside of them and playing with our norms." Before I pass things off to Adam, I would like to thank Toby Devin Lewis, the presenting sponsor, and others who are making this event possible, including National Council sponsors, corporate and media partners, and all of you who support the important mission of Anderson Ranch. I'd also like to remind you that the ranch's annual art auction is this Saturday, and all of the works are on view today in Wiley Center and in the main building. Pick up a catalog at the door on your way out and head on up and view these works if you've got the chance. And now, please join me in a very warm welcome for Adam Lerner. Thank you.
Wow, thank you so much, Rona. This is such a magical place. You are very, very lucky to have it so close to you, and I am thrilled to be here. So thank you to Nancy for inviting me, and thank you to everybody at this magical, soulful institution. What a great pleasure for me to be able to have a conversation with Alex Prager in front of you. Alex Prager is a Los Angeles photographer and filmmaker. And I put a little bit of extra emphasis on the Los Angeles because so much of the essence of the work is about that which emerges out of what it means to be in Los Angeles. She's been demonstrating her mastery at staging powerfully elusive scenes since the beginning of her career work, which was about 12 years ago. And she has been recognized for this work through solo exhibitions at places such as the St. Louis Art Museum, the National Gallery of Victoria in Melbourne, and the Corcoran Gallery of Art. Her film series, Touch of Evil, commissioned by the New York Times, won her an Emmy in 2012. Both her film and photography reference the history of cinema as well as the history of art and photography, as well as popular culture. And in everything that she creates, she demonstrates meticulous attention to production, especially her use of color and light. But these elements are the touchstones for something much more profound. And those profound issues that are brought out in her work through the means of those elements, that's the subject of this conversation today. That's what I would like to sort of have Alex sort of share with you. It's what I've found so meaningful in her work. So we'll begin the program with her most recent short film, La Grande Sortie, and then I will call Alex up to the stage for about a 30-minute conversation, and then we'll turn it over for question and answer for the remainder of the hour or so. So now we're going to have the screening of La Grande Sortie.
We're always rushing.
If you hadn't argued with the waiter at the restaurant about your iced tea.
In America, you always get a free refill.
Sa première performance en quelque sorte depuis la route. Il a écrit ce morceau. Au moins, je t'en écrirai un aussi un jour.
Là où la femme et moi, on vient ici depuis une vingtaine d'années. Ouais, pareil, c'est bien.
Vos billets, s'il vous plaît, mesdames et messieurs. Your tickets, please.
Levé de rideau dans 2 minutes.
So it's my great pleasure to welcome to the stage Alex Prager. Alex, that was amazing, incredibly intense.
Thank you.
And I just would like to start with just the very concrete aspects of it. Can you tell us, what were the circumstances surrounding the making of this?
Well, I made it with the Paris Opera Ballet. Benjamin Mipier called me up. He lived in Los Angeles at the time, but was also the director. Oh, the slides aren't working.
Can we get an image? Thanks. Yep.
Anyway, so I was asked to make a film for the Paris Opera Ballet's project, their new digital platform. So they wanted to bring dance to the internet and digital, so people could see it all over the world and modernize it more. And so they told me that I had full creative freedom and that I could use the dancers and the Paris Opera Ballet team and space however I wanted. So I said yes, I would do it, and then we found out that the timing of it was going to rely on, was going to kind of be dictated by this space, the space that was available. So the Paris Opera Ballet, I think they're having shows like 360 days a year. So there were really only a few slots that were going to work for us, and the one that they finally came back to me with was like, it was like 3 weeks or something after I said yes. So I immediately got my team together in Los Angeles, and I got my costume designer that I've been working with for the past 10 years or so, and my first assistant and my cinematographer that I work with, and told them what the project was. I kind of scribbled on a piece of paper, and because I had full creative control, it was just exactly what I probably would have done for my next art project anyway, because this, it's just very personal to me, and it comes right out of Facing the Crowd, which deals with crowds and, you know, the psychological and emotional aspect of what happens when you're in a crowd. So it led straight into this.
Yeah, so I'd love to be able to dig into some of those issues that are raised. I almost feel like we could spend the entire time just talking about this work, because almost all of your issues are embedded within it.
My issues.
Your issues. Yeah, all your issues. Yeah.
Sorry. All of our issues.
All of human.
Hopefully.
All the issues of humankind. All the issues that you explore in your work are embedded within it. So on one hand, there is this very clear dichotomy or duality between the audience and the stage,
mm-hmm.
Which is also like on some level like art and every day or something like that. You have like this very mundane beginning, you know, people kind of getting to the theater. But then also like there's this arrival of this moment of this consummate moment of intensity on stage, right? That then becomes this contrast, I'd say, to the you might like the detachment of an audience, which is ultimately broken. Do you see that kind of tension, this dualism in those terms? Is that has that for you run through this work?
I mean, there's definitely an energy, a relationship between an audience and a performer or somebody that's on a stage, like this and us. There's definitely something happening here, and there's an anticipation of this moment as well, right, that a lot of people feel. Not everyone, but it's intense to make yourself vulnerable on a stage to a sea of anonymous, like mostly anonymous people that you probably will never meet, but you can connect to through that moment. And when thinking about it, the ballerina or the ballet dancer, who's usually they're deciding to do ballet professionally at the age of 6 or 7, like she, Emily Cosette here, started with the Paris Opera Ballet School when she was 9 years old, and she became an etoile at the age of 26. Yeah. And it's interesting. Like she's dedicated her entire life to dance, and then on stage she'll be giving everything she can to the performance, and then if you look at the audience, oftentimes you'll find people falling asleep, or people checking their phones, or someone yawning, or whispering about something they forgot, like did they turn the oven off? And it's not a bad thing. It's just that this is one moment in their life, and then other things happen when they leave. But for her, it's a moment between life and death. I think for art, it's giving everything in that moment, and so much so that she needs to pop at the end because it's so much emotion is filling her, you know. And then there's the aspect of the you're your own worst critic. So a lot of times, just because somebody yawns or clears their throat, it doesn't necessarily mean they're not enjoying the performance.
Although we don't want anyone yawning or clearing their throat.
If I see anybody falling asleep, but. You know, when you're up on a stage, you're vulnerable, and if you have any sort of anxiety or stage fright, and it can be amplified by this energy in front of you, and suddenly the yawn can turn into like the New York Times critic watching your show, just looking at you, and so that's why at the end I have her sort of a doppelganger, just being really. Just wanting to leave the performance. It's good to show other pictures. So I also shot a series of still photographs while I was filming the movie. So that's what we're looking at now.
So her emotional experience, I mean, she's not just a master at her craft. She's actually, she's feeling things. You could tell is intensity of feeling. That's
well, I think to become a master, I think it's you feel everything in that aspect. Like even listening to Charles Ray talk the other night, he's so sensitive and emotional, and I loved seeing that side of him when he was talking about his work, because you don't necessarily always think that about sculpture, that inanimate object. Maybe you think that he comes at it more conceptual or. But I think it always starts from a very personal and emotional place if you're mastering your craft.
So that's something that I think is something that maybe goes through your work, this idea of this, something like that, like you touch on something internal in the experience, right? That you're maybe like you're look at this person with eyes often gets you some access to something that is the profundity of like this turmoil or emotion that a person's feeling. Can you talk a little bit about that in your work?
Well, I think if I'm, because this project came about so fast, there was no time to think about it analytically. It was pure emotion, just scribbling down what I wanted the dance to look like. And it felt very impulsive and slightly irresponsible considering the scale of the production. But looking back at it, seeing all of these strange coincidences, like for instance, I kept wanting the background to be green for the performance, and the set designer kept having the painter do blue. And I thought that it was a language barrier because we kept having these language issues come up because we were shooting it in Paris. And then finally I found like a crayon or something or something that was green, like the exact color green. And I was like, no, like this. And he was like, oh, no, we can't do green on stage because in France, that's considered bad luck. There's superstition around it because the dyes back, I guess, at the beginning of theater they were poisonous. So people would get sick from the color green. And so there's that. And then I found out after we chose Emily Cosette to be the dancer, we found out that she had actually been gone for 1 year. Because she was pregnant and she needed to take a year off. And so it was a coincidence that I also had my Etoile dancer. It was her first performance after being gone for a year. And this was Emily Cosette's first performance after being gone for 1 year. So I feel like, I don't know, I'm not really answering your question, but I feel like I'm talking about something totally unrelated, actually. But I just find this interesting that because it was so impulsive and it happened so quickly, we kind of had to just hope that things fell into place, and it was such a whirlwind project, and I think that comes through in the film. Mm-hmm. It's a very emotional project, I think, for everyone that worked on it.
Sure. Well, I think that level of emotional intensity is, I think, one of the core aspects of your work as I see it. I want to read a quote from the voiceover at the end of another short film you did in 2012, La Petite Mort, and the voiceover at the end of a short film where a woman is sort of hit by a train and then falls into a pond or lake and then emerges in front of a crowd and then encounters a man and then also collapses at the end. And then the voiceover reads, "It has been said that the act of dying and the act of transcendent love are two experiences cut from the same cloth. The former, a grand exit, the latter, a slow escape, man's closest moment to seeing God." And I feel like that, in some ways, could be used in so many of your works.
Yeah.
Can you want to talk about that?
Yeah, it's funny. I was talking about this film in Paris to a journalist, and she said that she was wondering if it was coming out of fear, that the like stage fright and the anxiety, and she was asking me if it came from a place of fear, and that's why I needed to make this work. But really, it's coming from a place of love, like. There's nothing more that I love than making my work and having it connect with people. So this, but it's scary. It's not necessarily easy or comfortable.
Yeah.
No one said it was going to be comfortable or easy. It's just something you imagine, I guess, when you start off. But there's so much love there. So I think, and sometimes it's so uncomfortable that it almost feels like I need to separate my intention from my body, because my body can become very uncomfortable too with anxiety and all kinds of things. I mean, I don't want this to be a therapy session.
We can talk about
other things too. but that's definitely something that I like to explore, because I think a lot of people feel these same things. Like when I talk to my friends or family members or just other people in at shows, I think a lot of people are feeling similar things, not necessarily triggered by the same things, but we're humans and we have a lot of emotions.
Yeah, and those emotions can create the possibility of this transcendent experience.
Mm-hmm.
So that actually, I feel like, starts to relate to a tension that you are always exploring your work between. I mean, here there's a very, in this series, compulsion, you have these diptychs. There's an eye and some extraordinary event.
Mm-hmm.
And...
Or typical of Los Angeles roads.
Cars just do that in LA.
We have tons of potholes. not that big. I exaggerated it a bit, but...
And so I feel like in some ways this is too, like this audience on some level, audience and some staged act
mm-hmm.
on some level, like there's that. But what I think is interesting is that it's not, the person is not, the eye is not just an observer eye.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just observing the act. It looks almost like the eye is engaged in some internal kind of experience, like so its own internal, invisible emotional experience. Do you want to talk about that what you're seeing in this tension?
I'm just interested in the spectator as well, like hearing stories about things that you can't really do anything about and still reading about it and still being interested and still talking about it and then going on with your day. I think that that's really interesting and that's definitely something that we have in culture. To an extreme right now.
Sure.
Because we have access to more information. So it's just coming at us all the time. And I think that, I mean, this series I did a while ago, but it's about the spectator.
If I could push you just a little bit further on that, though, because, in fact, there's very often not a pure spectator, someone who's just detached, but actually... In this case, the spectators, in fact, become, first of all, they're staged themselves.
Mm-hmm.
They walk onto their own stage of a spectatorship, the same way that the actor does. And there's a kind of intensity on some level
mm-hmm.
To what it means to be a spectator. I feel like your work says, like, even like the everyday has the possibility of the transcendence in it.
Mm-hmm.
Is that something that you're... that you see in the work as well?
Well, yeah, even the story you told, I won't tell them, but the story you told right before we came up.
It's
like, just like life is full of these interesting stories, and sometimes they can be completely just out of what you would expect reality to hold. And I don't know, I think it's interesting to explore that and also to stylize it to some degree as well, because this is reality. Like, these things have happened to some degree or another. They're stylized and they're slightly exaggerated sometimes, but nothing in here. It's all shot. It's really important to me, actually, this leads me into this, is it's really important to me to shoot film, because and everything that you see is actually something that I built or existed in a physical sense. And even in La Grande Sortie, we kept, everything was done with practical effects, because I needed it to be tangible and physical, because I think that people respond to the physicality of it in through film and the texture of the grain and all of that, but also there's the stylization and the texture of the grain adds a separation to what you're viewing. So although this is a stylized beach scene, but it's still a beach scene that can completely exist in pretty much, I mean, a lot of beaches that I've been to could totally have this beach scene, and it's existed for a long time. Like, you could go back 50 years and see the same beach scene, but it's stylized so that I think it adds a bit of, I think adding a bit of space when you're looking at something allows you to view it in a different way, and then underneath it, hopefully you find the layer of truth there as well. I think in the 1920s and 30s and even later, I think Hollywood was using that as a tool to show many different subject matters that might otherwise be very difficult to look at. Mm-hmm. But they, because there was this stylization to it and this gloss of Hollywood over everything, it allowed people to interact with the movies and respond.
Sure. No. I mean, I feel like so much of your work can be described as that moment in The Wizard of Oz when, you know, Dorothy goes from Kansas to Oz, and all of a sudden everything emerges in Technicolor. Like, it seems to me like that your work is about, in some ways, like, how can we sprinkle sort of sparkle dust on the world, you know, like sort of magic, you know, whatever it is, like a magic. But that's maybe mixing my movies. But like, how can we create like magic in the world? And I think there's something about this which seems so ordinary, but yet it feels like somebody sprinkled sparkle dust on it. So how do you make these photographs?
So this series, this was from Face in the Crowd, which led me into Grande Sortie. Okay. So this one, we had 350 extras. We had shot everything on a soundstage over 4 days, and we had like 75 crew members, and everything is artificial, except the people, really. But the lighting and everything, and the sets that we built. I guess there's only one of Face in the Crowd in here, but all the sets we built are artificial. That was like... That's not from Face in the Crowd.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. But I just want to show you a little bit of a set. Another set.
Another set. So that was from, I was shooting this picture. And so that's me underneath plexiglass shooting. And yeah, it was a lot of work. But the Face in the Crowd series. But it was a very clear intention, very clear vision of what I wanted. So, and a great team. I always work with the same people. Once we fall into a rhythm with each other, it makes my life a lot easier, and sometimes an idea that I had can morph into something else even more interesting because of the team I've been working with for so long.
Yeah, wow. And if you could actually just say a little bit more about your interest in crowds. I mean, it's a theme that also goes throughout. There's some works that have this emotional intensity, and there's also of a singular individual, and there's also your interest in having a large group of people.
I think it's I think there's just so much going on in crowds that's so interesting. Like with Face in the Crowd, I think more attention to the details on each person because I became obsessed with these characters and what made up this character, what was personal to them, that, you know, like starting to imagine this guy that maybe bought a suit in his mid-30s or something and loved the way he looked in it and has been wearing that suit ever since, and now it's 40 years later and he's still wearing the same suit when he goes to something fancy. I just love these stories that people have and carry with them, and you can look around at people and kind of, you can make up stories or you can, just observe what might be there. And I think it's.
Yeah, that's good. That's great. there's also another idea of looking, which is, you know, so much a part of your work. There's often people looking at something or looking at maybe nothing. Where does that come from for you? Like whether it's the audience or whether it's, you know, the series of with the brick wall, where there are people sort of staring at a brick wall.
Yeah, and also this one here, I wanted to say something about.
Oh, sure.
Where is it? Oh, yeah, so this one of people looking. I started to get interested in, because I stylize these to a certain degree, and I've been trying to meld different time periods in, so you never quite know what time period the photograph exists in. So this could be anywhere from the 70s or 60s, maybe even 50s, all the way up to now, because people in Paris dress really well, and a lot of people, I just kept them in their outfits that they wore to set. But also, if you look closely, I'm not sure if you can see it, there's also like blow-up dolls that we used as people and mannequins scattered throughout. I had my sister, who's a painter, paint some of the people. So there's like cardboard cutouts that are painted faces. And I just started exploring more the world of the artificial mixed with the real. Mm-hmm. And because I think that that's where it becomes really interesting.
Mm-hmm. Just on that, the art of, how does that parse with this dichotomy also between like maybe like what's real and what's like magical? Does that term have any resonance for you in your work?
Like what the what's real and what's magical?
No, like the idea of the magical, creating some, because it feels like that would be a term that I often describe.
Well, yeah,
for what's
I would love for you to describe it as a little bit of magical.
Because I mean, especially like, you know, there's some scenes that feel like, wait, is there something here or is there nothing here?
This was actually the group of girls I used to meet with, my old book club. And
I want to be a part of that.
We would have our book club inside, and then afterwards we'd always go out. And usually we would drink wine, not Budweiser. But one day we were just talking about love in the time of cholera or something in the hot tub drinking wine, and I was like, this needs to be a photograph. So the next time we did book club, I got them all together. This is actually from a while ago, but.
Great. So I would love to be able to open it up to questions. So maybe we can. And what I'll do is I'm just going to ask that you, because this is recorded and will be on the internet, we want to just, if you could just wait till you have the microphone in your hand before asking the question. And I'll choose people. And so they're going to bring a microphone over to you, sir. So one second.
Thank you. Could you please talk about the sense of distance in your characters? They seem to be present but not available.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, you're talking about the crowd pictures?
Or the individuals, or just the characters themselves. There's a distance.
I think that there needs to be, for me, when I'm looking at art, there needs to be, actually, Nikki Haas is here, not to call you out, but we were just talking about this last night, about how there needs to be a bit of a space in the work that almost to where it's not fully completed, so that there can be room for the viewer to interpret what they want in there. So if somebody was like this all the time in every picture, you know exactly what emotion they're expressing. And for me, when I'm looking at work, I like there to be that room to put whatever emotion, whatever baggage I'm carrying or whatever emotional train I'm riding that day, the more space that there is, as long as there's a specific clear vision from the artist, it allows for that interaction and that, it's, you know, communication, so it needs to be a two-way flow.
Since we're on this photograph, and I have the microphone, is this a reference to another work?
Yeah.
We
that's
tell
my
us?
William Eggleston reference.
I love it.
Thank you.
Can we go over here? Maybe? Or she could just...
He actually, that's the first show I ever saw, and I became a photographer that same week.
In La Grande Sortie, it almost looked like the main ballerina became transgendered in a way. You know, the seeing her face upside down and her eyebrows were very, you know, applied, but there was, you know, a full eyebrow underneath. Can you talk about kind of your methods of changing her over the course of the experience?
Yeah, I just wanted, I just knew that I needed her to be spiraling into this place that was no longer who she started out as. So to make her as non-specific and wild as possible. So we kind of like the eyebrow wax that we originally had to cover her eyebrows, we kind of messed it up so that her real eyebrows started to come through, but we still had the line from the drawn on eyebrow. And I still wanted her to look beautiful, so I didn't want to like smear her lips, because it just seemed too, like I would be saying way too much about her. I mean, it's weird to say that, because obviously I'm saying a lot in the film, but there's fine lines for me where there's still space for the viewer to kind of interact with it and put their own emotional emotion onto it. But you know, tousling her hair, and there were certain things I wanted to keep clear though, like her costume. I wanted to stay the same, and the shoes, and so it was specific things that I felt like could move in that direction, and other things needed to stay firm.
Over here, I've got like plenty more questions if you don't. But over, are you heading over here? Oh, she's got it. Okay, good. Wow, you guys are efficient.
Alex, I've got a curious question. It's more about your process as you've kind of started essentially as a still photographer and you've moved into film. And it sounds a bit dumb, but it's a bit of an observation that a lot of people, when they make that transition, they are not nearly as successful as what you appear to have become. And how, I guess what I'd be curious about is asking, how have you kind of maintained the visual and conceptual kind of integrity that your stills had years ago and continue that strength in all your film work? Because I think your work is phenomenal and you're genius at how you've transitioned throughout that.
I think it's probably, thank you very much. I think it's probably just, it was never, I was never looking at it as photography and film. I was just trying to express something personal. And so when I saw William Eggleston's work, I knew that there was something in there that was magical. And I wanted to find out more about what that magic was because it really resonated with me. So much so to the point where I quit my job, I bought a darkroom, and all of the chemicals, and I was making my own pictures that same week. Like, it was very extreme. It was like a divine moment for me. And but it wasn't like photography is the thing that I want to do. It was photography is wonderful, and I consider myself a photographer. But that was a medium for me to communicate in. And then in 2008, I had never thought about making films. But in 2008, I had a show, and I think this might have been one of them. So a lot of this was my Alfred Hitchcock reference. I like to put those in every once in a while. But a lot of people at the exhibition were coming up to me asking me what happened to her just before this moment, or like what led up to this, or what happened to her after. And I was like, are you kidding me? I'm a photographer and this is still. So this is funny, but it happened over and over. So I just, so despair, which is,
it's over here.
Yeah. This was, this is also a film. That started from this photograph idea, and I just decided to show people what happened just before and just after. So this film was 3 minutes long, and I really went into it thinking about stills in a series, like chronological series. So I wasn't thinking about film as like a, I was thinking about it as a moving picture, which is essentially what film is. And so it took me a while to catch up to that, to start thinking about it as film and narrative and storytelling, which is how I think it just evolved very organically.
But it's as if you don't, you show a little bit more, but you don't, you really circumscribe how much people can see. Because even in despair, she gets news on the phone, or she hears something on the phone, and then runs through the streets, and then goes through a building in despair, and then ultimately jumps out of the building, but we don't know anything about why that happened. You almost want to say, well, what happened before that, or what happened after that?
Yeah, it'd be interesting to see. I mean, I think I tell a little more in La Grande Sortie, which I made 4 or 5 years later. So it'll be interesting to see how I can keep that space that I feel is really important, like not telling all while still keeping my integrity as an artist but also telling a story, an actual story, a linear story. Yeah, I think that would be an interesting challenge. Yeah?
Oh. The picture of Alfred Hitchcock and the birds picture. How do you do that? I mean, obviously that's not a real picture. So how do you create that?
Unfortunately, we hired some birds and tied strings around their feet. And this was before I was a little more conscious of that, but we tied strings around their feet and pinned them to the model. And then we had somebody underneath her with a box of birds, and we'd count to three, and they'd open the box, and the other birds would go wild because they couldn't fly around. That's how the photograph was made.
Sorry. I could change the photograph. Kids moving here.
Alex, can you talk about how you went from being a girl with a darkroom and a camera to working in such large-scale production? What were the steps, or how did you get from point A to point Z?
I think being a little bit naive, I think, helped because, just in the beginning, because I didn't ever quite know what I was in for. So I would come up with an idea, and then I'd be committed to the idea, and then I would bring my producer in, and we'd have a meeting, and then we'd talk about the logistics. And it was just something, once I committed to the idea, there was no going back, so we would just figure it out. And growing up in Los Angeles, seeing movies being made all around me, movies show you everything that's impossible to do. There's nothing a filmmaker can't do, as long as they have the right team and the right creative mind and the right budget to be able to do it. But also, before the budget, it's really about being creative and coming to an idea of how you're going to do it. Because there's always different avenues of how to make something and coming to the same place. So I think that that's also how I came to the style of having everything a little bit off. I don't like anything to be too glossed over and perfect. So if a wig is a little askew, I actually prefer it. And I think that comes from my beginnings of having hardly any budget, but having a great team and a great creative mind and the initial idea. And then we just, you know, things got bigger and bigger. But it was always the commitment to the idea in the beginning.
Can you just say something a little bit about your non-traditional background, like how you became an artist?
Well, it was really just the William Eggleston exhibition. I saw that and taught myself photography.
And what were you doing before that?
Just hanging out.
Cool. That's
no, amazing. I was looking for something. I knew that I had this energy that needed to go somewhere, and it was important to me to find a vehicle for it.
This is kind of about the birds also. So sometimes I think photos are nowadays collections of images put together via Photoshop or whatever software, and a magic is achieved through creating some constructed space that doesn't exist anywhere else. But with yours, are they all real? Like
the
birds is a
house?
Single capture of one image in time. So I'm just curious, like, do you use both methods or just one?
Oh yeah, I love Photoshop. So it's really it's really about, like, this, for instance, the way we made this is we had a 9-foot model house built, just the facade, and I had 4 minutes to shoot it before the whole thing was ash. So
it really was on fire.
Oh yeah, it was on fire. I had a fire crew there. We went out to Simi Valley or somewhere, and I only had enough money to build one 9-foot model house. So they were like, okay, are you ready? And I had my film camera. And during that 4 minutes, I had to keep switching roles too. And this one, I shot the freeway. And then I shot the way I got the idea for this actually was there's a place called Costco in Los Angeles. And behind Costco, there was a huge hole in the ground. It was kind of like a shallow hole though, but it was filled with water because it had just rained miraculously in Los Angeles. And so I thought it would be interesting if a car fell into it. And so I shot the puddle one day, and then I shot the the freeway. Another day, I just had my friend keep driving me past this one area on the freeway, and we'd take the exit and go back around just in circles till I got the shot that I wanted. And then I had a car. It's actually not that expensive to buy a car that's completely done. Like, you can't fix it anymore. So you're basically just buying the body. So we have some friends that have this massive pool, and we shot the car. We got a crane and held the car in the water, dipped it in the water. So Photoshop was needed, obviously, to put the elements together, but each element is real and physical.
That's really special. Thank you.
What? Thanks for letting me ask another question. Have you, when you look at other art now, you know, if it started with the Eggleston show, how much of that is French and surrealist? Because I see so much Man Ray and Magritte.
Yeah.
And then you got to go to France and work with the Paris Opera Ballet.
Yeah, it's definitely a huge influence for me. The surreal is always of deep interest.
Could you just address the issue of gender in your work? And the protagonist is almost always a female character. You're even in a crowd, there's often a female character who is your eyes focused on. Tell me where that comes from and what that meaning of that is for you.
It comes from here. I happen to be a woman. Yeah. So the work is very personal. So what I'm going through is usually what I want to talk about. And I'm a woman, so that's how that came about. But I'm interested in men as well. especially this guy in the front.
Beefcake, man.
You can probably end it there, right?
All right. Wait.
Thank you.
That was nice.
Yeah.